I am now going to attempt to give you a very quick introduction to some of the heavy-duty concepts in 3D spatialized audio. There's a lot of terminology, and as I go into it with these guys, I don't want these things to just fly over your heads. So let's try to break some of it down. Elevation. So there's different ways in which audio can be detected and recognized and experienced by people. Some of these are easier to record and reconvey than others. For example, elevation is something that we can infer via reflections in the room, but it's otherwise difficult for us to identify. There's also front-back, the outer ear, the pinna filtering is a way that we can decide whether something is in front or behind us. ITD, interaural time differences, the very, very fast difference between the left and right ear receiving audio can give us an indication as to its position, the ITDG, the initial time delay gap, the amount of time, I guess this is like pre-delay, this is the amount of time between the origination of the sound and the time it arrives to us. We can get a sense of a room and its scale and even the nature of the materials in that room, the absorption and so on. ILD, interaural level differences, which is just, you know, is it louder in your right ear or in your left ear? Motion parallax. The travel speed of sound indicates proximity. So, parallax is this idea that when something is closer to you, it seemingly moves across greater distance at a higher rate. And the further away it is, it seems to move slower, right? So you get this kind of effect. And so that means that if something travels across your position very quickly, it must either be very close to you, or it's moving at an incredibly fast speed at a farther distance. So motion parallax is another way that we can identify the proximity of a audio event. And then there's a slightly complex concept, this HRTF, head-related transfer function. Essentially, and we're gonna drill down into this one because I think this is quite significant in this emerging space. HRTF has to do with recording, or basically recording your position in a environment. Generally, you do this with a pair of microphones, one in each ear, and then it accounts for what the nature of that room is in relation to your position. And once we've recorded this dynamic, you can basically physically model that relationship and place that into a virtual space. What's interesting is you can do a custom personal HRTF just for you, where it's just for your skull shape and the way that your ears are shaped and whether they're forward or back on your head. So it's really about the way that you hear as a person. But we'll get into how there may be certain universal HRTFs that are, you know, that work for pretty much everybody, or that seem to work for a broader audience. And these things, these models, these physical models, are essentially used in environments to create a much more immersive feel. An SDK, for those that are not in the programming space, is a software development kit, and people like Oculus will make these sorts of things free. They come with a whole set of tools, a lot of drag and dropping, and usually pretty good documentation. So it's not as esoteric sometimes as you may think to get involved in doing this stuff. For example, you may just have an object that you drop into a space in Unity or connect it to a listener object, and you're pretty much almost there for, let's say, an Oculus Rift or a Gear VR. Okay, here's a whole bunch of tools that currently exist. And I'm not going to give you a breakdown of each single one, but I'll leave it up there for a second so you can draw or take pictures or I'll give you slides or But these are sort of an aggregate of the current zeitgeist of software. The Astound Sound from Gen Audio, Blue Ripple Sound's Rapture 3D SDK, Dolby Atmos is a Pro Tools plugin for complex surround spatial mixing. FB360 is the newly minted rebranding for two big years, very well liked Spatialized software. So two big years is now FB360. That's free. And it used to be scary because you had to, I think anything you make with it belonged to Facebook and whatever, but they totally backpedaled on that, and they also made their VR camera now open source. They were getting a lot of flack for being super proprietary. HRTF is a company from LA that Grayson Matthews has been working with recently. Noisemakers is well-liked. AmbiHead and AmbiPen are their tools. There's the Oculus Audio SDK, which is free. Omnitone was just announced just a couple days ago. It's Google's new open source spatial audio renderer. So that's pretty substantial, actually, that they just kind of dropped on in there with the tool and made it free to everybody. Phonon 3D is quite a rich software tool suite. It's got various different modules and components, but some of those things are not fully functional yet. They're more prototypey. Sound Particles is a really cool tool that effectively, if you are into graphics or like motion graphics or computer, let's say 3D rendering or whatever, imagine a particle emitter but for audio. So if you have a scene, I was watching this little documentary about doing sound effects for Star Wars Episode 2, and there's this one scene where there's a billion lasers shooting, and George Lucas is like, there's so many more lasers than there have ever been before. And basically sound particles would allow you to just generate that. Instead of having to manually place every one, you would sort of create an algorithm and move some sliders around. And it can be used for anything from traffic to bird cheeping or whatever. So it's really an interesting thing to check out, especially when you're talking about a generator in spatialized audio, right? So you don't have to bake it down. It can be creating these things on the fly, effectively, at quite a level of depth. Harpex is another spatialized 3D audio solution from people who've been in the game for quite a long time. And FMOD and Wise are quite different than everything else up here, but they're game engine audio pipeline solutions. Yeah, they're middleware. They basically let you, trigger sounds and build event-driven audio and so on. Okay, so these are the guys that are going to talk with us about this. David is from Grayson Matthews, a very busy music and post-audio production facility in Toronto. It's a beautiful historic space. They've got a very cool attitude about the work that they take on and how they approach it. And I've had the opportunity to meet with a couple of the guys there that are very enthusiastic about VR audio, and we have different opinions and interesting opinions about things that can be done. And Anne-Marie works at the post office, which is another audio post-production facility, and have worked with various VR clients, including Shaftesbury and the CFC. They also worked on Sonar. I think Sonar was FiveArs's People's Choice last year, a German project, stereoscopic. Really, really sold that sense of personal space and presence. And Grant Edmonds works at the Dark Studio and is an Gemini award-winning audio mixer for many different projects, documentaries, and so on, and brings to us a lot of film mixing experience and his observations on how to best apply that into this middle space that we are in now. And David Federman is a composer who has a lot of insight into what it means to compose for immersive media. And you know, I think one of the first things I observed curating Five Arts was how many 360 projects had no music at all. It was like they were just afraid to deal with that part of it. But when it's there, it works really well. And it's just interesting to consider what diegetic versus non-diegetic elements could be when, you know, is the music something that just exists everywhere? Is it like a skybox, or is it spatially oriented? Does it change as you move from one area to another? So that's why I put this particular panel together. These guys all come from a creative side. They also have a technical background, and are all, I would say, in that just interesting gray space that exists now between an era of true spatialized 3D audio. And here's the last thing I'll say before we get into it and pass it on to them. I remember when I first started at UCLA in a directing program, the first exercise was about audio. They said, you know, to be a director, you have to strip away everything and then rebuild the audio from scratch, which was a real epiphany to me because up until that point, I was just shoot whatever, the audio was this thing that happened. But when I stripped all the audio away and I had just a picture, the decision to what I would put back in was everything. It was all of the cues. It was the subtle, the subtext, the nuance, the indication of what direction to look at. And it was a real revelation to me. And I've always felt that audio was kind of the soul of the piece. It's the kind of the undercurrent, that spiritual like underpinning of a piece that gives you a sense of where you should be emotionally. And so I'm excited for how this can turn into a VR thing, a spatialized VR thing. Let's just start somewhere. We'll look at what the current state of the market is, what tools you guys are using right now. And then maybe we'll get into some more philosophical components after we've established what's even possible right now. One other thing I'll point out is that these three worked all on a project called BURNED, B-V-R-N-E-D, which is one of Canada's first scripted VR narrative pieces in a larger scale productions. All in different parts of the process. So there's an interesting thing there where you get three points of view on one project. We're lucky to have the producer, Lucy LaLumiere, and the director, Jeff Priera, here as well. So they can tell you if anybody up here is lying or not. Let's start at the end with David. Why don't you talk to me a little bit about what you guys are encountering as a facility in creating VR projects right now?
Okay. Let's give you a little background on who we are. We're a fairly large facility of post studios. We do a lot of television, film, commercials. But we're also a house of composers. There's 12 in-house composers. I included in that group. So when VR started coming about in the last, I'd say, 18 months to a couple years, we started, well, a few of us really jumped in pretty headlong and said, just excited about the medium. And as it started to progress, realizing as we were working on experimental stuff and smaller projects, the workflow was painful. It was difficult. Commonplace, obviously, for any of you guys out in the audio space, Pro Tools is pretty widespread. Logic, Ableton, whatever you're working in to compose or mix. So for us, it was really understanding how we could get simple workflows so that we can enable people in our organization with a lot of experience writing music and mixing music, enabling them with tools to quickly work in the medium, and we realized that was very difficult. So we started a little while ago inside of Reaper using some of the readily available Amazonic plugins and 3D mixing plugins. But in the last little while, things are starting to take shape on the software side. We're working with a couple people, a couple small groups of developers to work on tools to enable those people that don't want to jump in too heavily on the tech side with complicated workflows. So I think 2 Big Ears was the first platform that they developed. I think the reason why they took off quickly is that they developed a platform or a workflow that was fairly simple, and it integrated with Pro Tools and integrated with familiar audio workstations. It was a simple plugin with a simple GUI, and it came very quickly. You understood the medium as you played around sound, and I think I'm not gonna pass it down the line, but I think that was the first tool that enabled for a lot of us within our organization to understand, at least the people that weren't diving in too deeply, just to play around the concepts and move sound within degrees in 360-degree space, give it height, give it depth, and understand the possibilities of sound in 3D space. Most of us, we've been to an Dolby Atmos in a theater. I mean, that's the closest. Without putting a pair of headphones on, in a physical environment, you'll hear sound in a physical space. So in VR, obviously the goal is to create the illusion of three-dimensional sound within a headphone experience. And I think right now, on the road with a lot of plugins, a lot of developers are jumping in this pretty heavily. But for us, like I said, the idea is to get simple tools and simple workflows in the hands of the most experienced composers and engineers.
Yeah, I was thinking just define what 3D spatialized audio is just of its own accord. I mean, I've given all of these definitions of the terms that are related in creating or considering how to do it, but 3D spatialized audio is when you are able to position sound in three-dimensional space. That means it's not just glued to your head left and right and turn, but then when I turn my head, that object remains over where it is. And I can move under it or over it or whatever, but that's the idea, basically. So you can get a very powerful sense of things in the distance and close by. And, when you're dealing with room scale VR, for example, it feels like you're in a giant open space, but you're really in an 8x8 cage. So audio is actually a very interesting way to expand that dimension and make things happen way over there. That helps to build that sense of immersion. Would you guys have a different definition of what 3D spatialized audio is, or do you want to add to that?
Yes,
thank you.
I think you're right.
Okay, cool. As long as we agree on what we're talking about here.
Well, I think absolutely, and as things and as you fill in the space more, more sort of sophisticated your sounds and more a lot of the tools today, kind of what they do is they just sort of they apply like an EQ filter, a bit of reverb, and things sort of move around, and it's very it's really sophisticated, especially this piece of software is doing that for you and attaches it to to something that detects your movement, but for us in the audio business, it's really an opportunity to for years we sort of watched laptops sort of take away all the work we did because we work hard on films and stuff, and then we'd watch it on the laptop and all the bass frequencies that made people feel a certain level of emotion and disappeared. So what was nice, with VR is that it returns. We get to, it'll be headphone based, so we get some frequencies back, and we get to, carve out our craft again. Those of us that were, working in Hollywood films.
Because I think that one of the things we're going to have to reconcile with is that we're going to be dealing with audio in headphones. This is going to be a headphone medium. The near field monitors that gamers can use for elaborate stereo mixes. First of all, near field monitors are great for gamers because gamers are usually glued to their desktop. I mean, traditionally, they're very close to it. The speakers are going to stay in one position, and so you can design for that. But now, because we're moving people around, you're going to have these headphones pegged to you. So I know, David Federman, you were talking about in composing for VR, that this was actually a distinction for you from traditional composition.
Yes. As with all cases,
the object of the game is to make the director happy. And part of that includes considering the end user experience. The director or the showrunner or the game dev that you're reporting to is your first end user. So when I'm working on film or television, I will have my studio speakers calibrated to the correct volume to give the director an accurate sense of what it's all going to sound like in the theater. With VR, as you said, this is a headphone medium. So my goal was to get a good headphone mix, which is sometimes not the same as a good speaker mix. Yeah.
Just in terms of the headphone experience, it's so true that VR is all about that headphone experience. I just want to highlight one thing that is difficult in the medium is the end user experience is headphones, and we were talking before, what becomes difficult, especially in the music context while working with the director, is that collaborative process, because now, if you sat in a room and mixed music or mixed film, mixed television, you can sit in a room and listen to speakers, so you can actually listen simultaneously and, you know, point things out while they're going by, even you can talk about it while it's going by, and now all of a sudden we're in a situation where the end users wearing headphones, collaboration is very stunted. And you're sitting in a room, I've been in a room with a composer and a mixer, an engineer and a developer, and if you're passing headphones around and someone listens, you hear that car go by, and I think it needs to go a little more left, and you listen now. And the process, the fluidity with which we work is now all of a sudden very cumbersome, and I think that's one of the challenges for making content, especially with audio, is how do we collaborate again? How do we sit in a room together and work on something knowing that the end user is going to be on headphones?
Well, I was pointing out that if everybody is in headphones, then everybody's got a consistent experience, which is kind of awesome.
Yeah.
So when you have a badly tuned room, you don't have the client sitting in the back corner of the bass trap and saying, this sounds awful.
Yeah, so as much as we have a mix coming up where we're going to have all the clients sitting in the room with headphones on while the engineer will move 360 video, and then all the audio will be tracked and everyone's headphones simultaneously so that you can listen together, as opposed to having, you know, if there's seven people in a room, if you're dealing with a brand client as well, maybe an agency, maybe it's, you will have a lot of people in the room that you can't pass headphones with. So there needs to be a system where everyone can sit and listen and judge and make comments and, you know, be wowed together as a room. And I think that's an important part of figuring out workflows and process for this kind of work.
Anne-Marie, have you seen any kind of a system at post office for handling this, or are you guys working each by yourselves?
Mainly it's an American ear that's mixing, and he's, you know, monitoring the restricted headphones, and we usually trust that he's doing a great mix, and we'll listen over it, and I will implement it in Oculus app or the Milk VR app, and I'll play it back and listen to different versions. And I think that's another issue in itself. Besides collaborating, you know, you have to pass headphones around, but you also have to implement it and make sure it sounds the way it's intended.
So let's talk about what implementing means, and I think you and Grant might be interested in hearing from you guys about this. How do you go from the first stage of a mix where you decide that it just sounds good and here's the edit, right, and the balance, and then you're moving that into the VR space. So there's an Oculus stage, right? There's a stage where somebody's programming this audio into the experience?
For Oculus, what you need to do is you export your mix and you bake that into the video, and then the Oculus engine handles everything else.
And what is it doing to change that audio for VR?
So it manages all the head tracking and all the movement. If you're moving your head around or if you're leaning, the audio just kind of adapts to it.
Grant, how do you prepare for that when you're dealing with a mix coming from the pedigree of high quality film mixing that you do? How do you anticipate what Oculus is going to do to your sound?
You hope. a little bit of trial and error, like anything else. I haven't actually mixed anything called the Oculus, so I don't actually know what it would do. But the 3D projects that we've done, we've basically they're coming out like they're coming out as two speakers, so we sort of have a more of a radical stereo image, and then there's a mono track that would be like a dialogue stand that is manipulated by the software. And we take those things and we give them to the developer, and then they come back and say, well, the dialogue stand's too quiet or too loud because they can manipulate it by 3DB and we need to. So they're a little more, it's a little less sophisticated, but that's sort of how we're doing it. Works so far.
So for example, the Oculus SDK or whoever the developer is, has got terrible audio tools, so they're really relying on you to have high-level output and high fidelity because they're just basically able to place it in time? Or how is that? How does that work?
Yeah, I don't really know how it works, but as far as the audio tools, I think Unity's got a fairly sophisticated, audio features in it. But I've never actually used it myself. But we would do the same as we would do for like a film or something. We make sure everything's got like the kind of frequency response and it's clear and you can hear everything you want to hear and how it gets passed through the 3D programs. In this one case, it's just turns the level down by 3 dBs, which is, in my experience, almost like one notch. Like most people hear 3 dB as like, oh, that's one notch quieter. That's pretty much it.
That raises an interesting question, because when you're watching a film, everything is centralized in front of you. The director has an enormous amount of control over the timing and the frame and everything else, right? It's an exclusion that you're doing of everything else, but what you want to keep. Whereas VR, you're including everything. And this was an interesting conversation that I want to have. What happens when you can include everything at all times? Is the idea of VR as an audio platform one of inclusion or one of editorialization in a slightly different way? Oh, you guys can just pull that thing down. I don't want it to fall on your head. Yeah.
Okay, well, that's sort of the fascinating part of us, right? So, as we were talking earlier, what we always say in our business when people are looking for us is that microphones are stupid. Like, the microphone is not as sophisticated as your brain is. The microphone is just going to pick up, sounds irregardless. And whereas humans have the capacity to sort of, like, ignore things. Like, I know my children are really good at ignoring the sound of my voice. That kind of thing. Right, if you hear your name whispered across this room, your head immediately turns because your brain is really tied to the sound of your own name. So when we're mixing for film and television, what we're doing is we're basically telling the listener what's important to hear at every given moment. So we don't necessarily need to hear the sound of the robin on the grass outside or the snowmobile, but maybe you do, maybe that's what you're doing. So that's sort of our craft, right? So we design these things. And then, so in the world of VR, like, I don't know, like, I'm not so sure you want, people to have, you want to sort of engage them and want to give them some decision making, but, you want to sort of lead them. So that's sort of, where we're headed next. Like, I don't really know how that's going to work. Whether you give everybody, and then it really becomes like a software side of things, like how you, the software designers are going to be like doing more of that kind of work than we would be doing. Like it's sort of a wild west as how that takes place. But if I was involved in stuff, I would want my natural inclination would be to sort of manipulate it in carbon, so that you have kind of like faux decision making. You decide between two or three things. How about like a cacophony of sounds that you get to choose from.
David, I think you have an interesting opinion on this I wanted to hear from. So, before you do, I just wanted to add again to clarify this. Let's imagine that we have a 360 sphere around us, and we want to create this deep level of immersion. Is it more immersive to give somebody the wind through the grass and the density of the air and the cars off in the distance and the children playing in the park, and let our natural human capability or propensity to focus in on a particular thing decide which part of that sound field we want to concentrate on, or do we creatively decide what to eliminate? And like I said from my original directing class at UCLA, is that strange sound? See, just like that. I just decided to focus on that sound. Interesting. Anyway, so, or as a director, do I decide, no, you only need just this much, and that's all you need to get a complete sense of immersion. Dave, what's your point of view on that as a composer, especially?
I think you should trust our sound designers to design the soundscape in collaboration with Keram, and whether that's for film or TV or games or VR. We can only listen to so many things at once. We really need to listen to so many things at once.
I just want to chime in here. I agree with you, David. I think it's the role of the sound designer and the director to kind of collaborate and decide what you want the audience to hear, what you don't, and what you want to convey.
Okay. I mean, I had a big argument with the guys over at Grayson Matthews about this, because there was the guys that are working in the 360 film, and there's the guys that are working on the game side. And in the game side, you've got a much more powerful engine or desktop or whatever behind you. You can afford to create all of these complex sound objects and so on. And so it's not as much of a concern as when you're doing it in a Gear VR, for example, or whatever else. So let's move over to that now, just to kind of get on a slightly more technical side. I know that Oculus' SDK has got an HD audio switch, or a fast audio switch, which degrades the quality of the sound exceedingly. What is your opinion on this? Would you, or I don't know if you guys have any experience working with this, but you know, how would you, is this like MP3, where you kind of boost certain frequencies in order to handle the destruction that MP3 compression does, or is there another way that you would handle that?
From what I've heard about the Oculus SDK, I haven't actually used it in depth as much, but what I know about it is that if you're using a lot of reverb or early reflections, then you want to change the high quality on instead of the fast version. But it also uses a lot more CPU, so that's another thing to consider. So, but I know it's something you can switch on and off if you need it or if you don't need it, so it depends on if you really want to bog down your CPU or if you don't.
And well, most people say it's just audio, so I'll just turn it off.
Yeah, it's just useless. 20% of the experience.
Yeah. I'm not going to give up all of this processing power for audio.
It's an interesting question. I mean, it's early days for VR, and it's developers on phone platforms or PC, whatever you're developing for, you always have the bandwidth issue. And I think the nice thing about VR is developers realize that they need to leave a lot of bandwidth open for audio, especially VR, because how important it is. Not only for the sense of realism, but you know, there's the issue also of people get sick in bad VR experiences. Horizons moving, or if there's too much camera movement, whatever it is, you can easily get sick. I don't know if anyone's experienced that, but it's very easy to get sick. And so it's even more important for creating, you know, a realistic sound environment so that your brain perceives it as real. As soon as your brain is disconnected from the audio and visual sound at the same time, it starts going, oh, I'm being poisoned, something's wrong here, and then you lose immersion, but then you can also go sick. So I think it's a great time for audio professionals in that developers have to leave that room. They have to leave that bandwidth there open, because now audio is even more important to the intense experience.
Yeah. Totally. Finally. Let's leave that headroom there to grow out into that space that I think audio is absolutely essential for.
Yeah, I mean, we're huge proponents and audio professionals of VR as an audio-only medium. You can still have an amazing audio-only three-dimensional experience. There's lots of examples out there, and that's what I'm very excited for, is the possibilities for audio-only in three dimensions. If you've heard great three-dimensional audio, it's a huge opportunity for music. It's a huge opportunity for audio-only experiences. Even if you think of the the podcast medium, how big it's become, but 3D audio and podcast medium could be unbelievable. There's so many opportunities for what VR is doing for audio that we don't talk about a lot because we're so early in the game, but it's huge. It's gonna be pretty great.
What I'm noticing emerging is a lot of ASMR videos, which is effectively ambisonic recorded videos, which could effectively be audio-only experiences. I remember the Disney company, well, about 20 years ago, if not more, experimenting with ambisonic installations at Disney World Epcot. So they've been on that, so it's now our time to shine.
You know, one thing that occurs to me about audio in VR is that, for example, we used to watch Ian Twosson's horror 360 stuff. Some people would be terrified because they were horror fanatics and they were looking for the scare. So they would turn around in all directions and try to find the, you know, the gray goo girl like walking at them. And other people would just stare, you know, straight ahead, terrified, and they would miss it all because it was all happening behind them. But what's cool about audio is that you don't have to look at it to know that it's there. We've got a piece in Five Arts called Waiting for Big Benny that's about a girl who's sort of stop motion in the forest and she's talking about how Big Benny's gonna come. And nobody turns around because they know it's behind them. Because you can hear it crinkling through the trees. And like, they just don't. So audio is this amazing thing because you don't actually have to turn physically to look and know that it's behind you. You have the sense, you can create dimension in this whole other way. And I think there's going to be a huge onus on sound design in VR. I mean, come on, like, what are we talking about here? Stereo is, you know, kept us sort of like handcuffed for so long. And this idea that not only is it 3D and spatialized and object-driven and event-based, but it's pegged to your head. I mean, this is so much more than, you know, an auxiliary to the visual. This is so much more than just supporting the visual. I think that you're going to have audio directors on a completely different scale that are dealing with narrative on a completely different level. So what do we have to do? Oh, go ahead.
No, I was just going to make a surprise comment that if there's going to be like audio only VR, then these people spend $700 on a headset. Pissed off because all I do is close their eyes and get my set of headphones. But anyway, I thought that sounded funny in my head.
Let's talk about ASMR for a second. My company, it's total self drug catch here. Transportive Technologies, a company I started last year, because my real first jolt into VR this round was for ASMR, and if I could find a way to deliver the therapeutic effects of ASMR into a VR experience. So, is everybody, who hands up if you know what ASMR is? About a tenth of you. ASMR stands for Autonomous Sensory Meridian Response. There was actually a documentary in Toronto about the subject called Braingasm, because that's basically what it means. And it's just that some people have a sensitivity to certain small behaviors or focused behaviors that creates this kind of crawling, euphoric experience in the back of their heads. And it's not so fringe. There's tens of millions of subscribers to ASMR videos on YouTube, and you can go at any time of day or night. This is usually people that are giving you a feigned scalp massage, or removing your makeup, or crinkling candy wrappers, or all sorts of little behaviors that are supposed to induce a real state of calmness and this sort of brain euphoria. There's even soldiers who write, you know, comments on these things and say, this really helped my PTSD. And so there's some kind of a therapy to this care, this simulation of someone doing something innocuous that kind of requires your attention but isn't really about you. And I started experimenting with one of the YouTube stars who was very good at this ASMR stuff. And the first challenge that we had was, it works in YouTube because you have this frame and the person could be reaching off the sides of the frame and pretending that they're rubbing your ears or stroking your hair. But what happens in 360 when you can suddenly just look up and see that their hands are in midair, and it just kind of breaks that entire suspension of disbelief. So we were really experimenting with what is the essence of ASMR that induces this state, because it may not be the visual, it may not be this, you know, hardcore Henry first person point of view of somebody doing something to you. Maybe it's the audio, that very delicate kind of way of speaking that makes your skin kind of tingle and crawl and you're like looking. So the original ASMR artist was Bob Ross, you know, painting with Bob Ross and the little happy trees. And that's why when they put his entire series on Twitch, it like blew up the internet. There's just millions of people watching it all at once. And I think it has something to do with the audio, this very delicate audio. Now the problem was in 360, I couldn't get my hands on a way to, so these artists have these binaural ear, these rubber silicone ears that they stick on a thing, and then they talk in one side, and then they talk in the other side, and they tap all the way around, and you get the sense that they're moving around your head. And I couldn't solve that problem on a Gear VR at the time that I was making this video. So we recorded this binaural audio, but I didn't know how to use it in 3D space yet. And I think it's a really interesting thing to explore. Like what, so for me the question is, if I was doing this today and I came to one of you guys and said, here's all my money, help me make this 3D spatialized ASMR video that uses a four-way set of silicone rubber ears to induce this brain gasm because it's really therapeutic for people who otherwise don't get that nurturing attention, how would you approach the problem?
First of all, the problem is visual or the audio?
The audio. Getting spatialized 3D audio on Google Cardboard or Gear VR.
Tool-wise. You're talking about software tools. Then you gotta figure out where you're doing. I think that's for all of us in any project, that becomes the first question you're talking about projects. Where is it gonna be deployed? Where are you deploying? So that's the first question. It's a YouTube delivery, YouTube will support spatial sound. Samsung VR and VR will support spatial sound. Google Cardboard, every player has a different form of their version of 3D sound. Some are better than others. And that's the first question. And then obviously mixing accordingly. Samsung VR, they have a very distinct set of specifications if you want to use spatial sound. And they'll, you can upload 5.1 sound, you can upload quad binaural, quadraphonic, and then the engine will essentially do the spatialization. Or you mix it, and the engine will actually do the head tracking. Likewise for YouTube, proprietary apps, I mean, that could be a place to deploy it, but I think that's the first question, and then it's a matter of creating a mix accordingly.
Well, I think another thing you need to think about is how are you going to record it in order for it to have an experience that you want. So one thing I can recommend is you can buy on mics. You know, the 3DO dummy head, it's got microphones. It's a dummy head that has mics in its ears, and you can utilize that, and also take the export of that and use that in mics.
So are the rubber ears, let's just call them rubber ears, are they like Ricoh Theta, where you've got a lens, a big wide angle lens on the front and on the back, and then you've got a single stitch and you cover the whole cone that way? Or would you rather use a holophone, where you've got like 10 different mics all the way around it? Do you think that's overkill, or is that what you really need to create true spatialized 3D?
I think the holophone's overkill, because that's more dealing with, I think, speaker feeds, not so much
Okay.
So I think specifically for your experience, I think you're right. I think simple is better. So it all depends on the experience. For that one, I think simplicity. But I think if you want to capture high resolution 3D environments, then your capture methods are important, or a bigger array of microphones. It's like camera resolution. The more lenses you have capturing 360 visual, better, you're going to be able to stitch to higher resolution, have more light in it, and you can take in more sensor density. Same with audio, like, it depends on what you're trying to achieve. That simple kind of sound, I mean, I think simple's better. If it was a musical experience that you wanted to capture in 360, then it's a matter of spatial microphones, single source microphones, all combined to create a very lush 360-degree mix. So it all depends on the content.
Grant, talk to me about what you would do as a mixer to create a pseudo surround state of audio. So, like, you could use filtering and EQs, and, you know, is this something that we can feasibly create instead?
Yeah, possibly. I was just thinking, like, back to the original question, how many microphones you use. I was working on this job today where there's people at an Irish pub doing traditional Irish music, and there was 7 or 8 microphones that we had to choose from. And they were never around the instruments that you want them to be as the camera moved, right? So, like, you know, the guy's close up with the guy's fretboard when he's playing his guitar, all I could hear was the singer. Nothing I could really do about it because I wasn't an arm at the time. So, yeah, it's definitely like scenarios where you want more microphones are better and options are better. But I forgot the original question.
The question is, so one way is I can be literal, right? I can put a microphone 50 feet away and 30 feet away and 5 feet away, and I could have a hollow phone where I've got 20 different mics and everything. Or can I fake it and just pretend like it is by using EQ filtering and proximity effects and so on with EQs, reverbs, and all that kind of stuff?
Yeah. Can fake it. I mean, it depends. There's certain things like we're used to listening to that are fake. Like, there's just sort of sounds in films, like guns don't sound that way in real life, right? Like, if you listen to the news, they sound completely different. And some do, you know. But something like that, like an actual, like the sound, what something sounds like when it's coming through a door, if you heard, you know, somebody, like in a movie where there's a high school principal and he's getting mad at the kid and the door's closed and you just hear the muffled voices and stuff, like, that actually sounds better if you do it for real than any, you know, or maybe, you know, maybe I'm not just doing it right, but no. That's sort of my experience. So, it kind of depends what it is. Animals sound better fake, I think.
The lion sounds.
Yeah.
The duck sounds.
Yes.
Wah, wah. David, you were talking about grammar. So the question was, this was a really cool answer that you gave me before. The question was, so what do we tell people in this room that came out of here to learn about what they can do? Because, you know, in VRTO, we like to be real action-oriented. We don't want to just talk about problems. How do we go home and do something about this today? And I said, so what is it that we can do with available equipment right now? And what would you tell people that go home and want to start to play around with audio that they can know to make it better today?
Right. And the answer I gave you was, and the answer I gave to you is, let's go exploring. Go and play. We are currently sitting at the confluence of so many languages and grammars from all of the arts that we have accumulated throughout human history. We have the past 30 years of video games, 100 years of cinema, thousands of years of storytelling, theater, and all of them seem to be coming together in VR. So the good news is, chances are, you already know what to do. The challenge then is putting it all together. And with so many companies in both the hardware and the software front working so hard to make these tools available and accessible and practically in everybody's homes right around the corner, I think that we can all contribute to what is going to become a corpus of culture in this new VR medium.
So imagine that the tools were not esoteric. How many of you guys is from audio? Are from audio? Well, I didn't ask if they were grammar police. I asked if they were audio.
We're talking about the language and the grammar of VR. You
know what
it is, audio?
I know what I heard. Okay, so everybody here is in audio. That's cool. So I told you guys I could deep dive. So let's assume that, okay, so let's just do a random poll. What do you use for audio mainly? Okay. Somebody raise their hand. Tell me what tools you're using.
Ableton.
Ableton.
Logic.
Pro Tools.
Yeah, what do you like, are you guys doing, okay, how many of you guys are doing audio for VR? Okay, like a tent. What are you using in the back as tools?
Three deception, you guys already mentioned it, a bit of Unreal.
Unreal. What are you using?
A lot of Unity, there's a few things that are
so you're authoring and you're creating the audio environment and everything inside of Unity.
Yes.
And do you find it easy? Is it hard to use Unity or is it easy to use Unity?
Now conversing in it, but that's not my first tool of choice. Overall, set of designs are quite limited, so there's some great features, and developers are able to iterate quickly with very little investment in terms of the tool set, and they can just make sound happen immediately, so that's really important. But for a sound designer with experience, you're going to burn out on just not having the tools that you require on that platform. So. Certain pop up at a certain point with Unity or Unreal or any game engine. Mostly you'll hit the end because it's an area of discovery right now. You'll hit the wall on your ability to do what you want to do because it's just so new. Everything's so new. So there's going to be something new that's going to come up that you're going to need the tool to do, but it can't do, and then you're stuff. So
yeah.
It's a constant grind through solutions.
But the thing is, do you guys remember what Logic used to be like 10, 15 years ago? It was holy hell. And then Apple took it over and they made it like this Fisher-Price and interface. And it's like, you know, Final Cut X. So what I'm leading to here is that the tools are now Fisher-Pricey enough that you can do it, right? You don't have to like be a hardcore programmer to understand algorithms and psychoacoustics and all that kind of stuff to get something going. So my question to you guys, as we start to run out of time, because you're such valuable resources in terms of your experiences, what would you say to people who have a Fisher-Price kit to do spatialized audio? What were the little bits of advice you'd say to make it really work and sing at this stage of the game? As designers, from a psychoacoustic perspective, for a deliverable perspective, like, you know, how do people deliver a finished product? What are the things that they should know about?
Well, I think the fact that Facebook Spatial Workstation is free and it works within audio workstations of all for live, that's a huge one. If you haven't experimented, that's a great way to start experimenting. There's lots of plugins available just to understand what's happening with audio when it's being processed for three dimensions. But if I rewind to what I started saying earlier, we're all looking for the simple workflow that we're familiar with that can translate into the medium. So, for example, from our perspective, taking a traditional 7-1 mix or a Dolby Atmos mix and being able to quickly translate that into a binaural mix down that's head tracked. So taking the parts of our process and our workflow that are very familiar and creating software that allows us to translate that from the workflow into a three-dimensional environment. And I think those software workflows are coming, and then we're working on them. I think lots of people are looking for them because the process right now is a bit clunky and it requires a lot of different software tools, whether in a game engine, whether in a workstation, an audio workstation. And trying to get all those things talking requires multiple people with multiple disciplines, and you know, and that's right now we're at that stage of finding new solutions to streamline that workflow.
Think about how you experience the world auditorily. Think about how you hear the world. Help us find all the limitations that exist and then help us break those limitations. Help us find solutions, help us find workarounds, and have faith that the tech is going to catch up with our dreams and ambitions.
But what would you do as a mixer, as a composer, if you were meant to deliver a project? I come to you and I say, I heard you're the VR music guy. Why are you the VR music guy and not Jim Guthrie who scores stuff for video games? What do you know about surround audio now? Or mixing for a project like Bird where it's a VR experience?
What I know is how to talk to directors and figure out how we can work together to overcome the current limitations and how we can simulate what we want musically and from an audio perspective.
And how did you overcome that with Bird?
We hit some limitations pretty early on in our testing. Jeff, our director, came to me when we were having our early meetings about Bird. And he was talking about, yeah, it's going to be great, it's going to, we're going to have head tracking and spatialized audio and all the rest. And then after some early tests, we figured, well, we've got a tech bottleneck here. We can't have great 360 video, because Jeff comes from a very well-established TV background. So his priority is going to be great video. So we can't have both great video and all of the reactive audio all at the same time. So we're going to need to scale things back, make some decisions, and...
Can I just add something? I'm the judge of the issue first.
It's a big thing.
Yeah, I want to make a distinction between music composition and sound design. And pretty soon, we have a grant that Brandon and Sarah are getting done, they're both excellent at what they do. But David's job was to compose the music, and that music doesn't need to be... For my film, I didn't want it to be spatialized, because it was going to be there as kind of background. But it served a certain purpose. My point is, what's essentially spatialized is great sound design. And it's not just a mix, it's a design that, you know, because with audio, I'm sorry, you made a really good point, is that because VR can be very disorienting, audio serves as your guide, as your, some can serve as your guide to that kind of disorienting. It's audio something we all get. When you follow the audio, it kind of keeps you grounded and keeps you safe. You know, so I think that was a really good point. So that was one of the things David and I, in our early conversation, figured, okay, so this is music, composition, it's not going to be spatialized, it's going to be this. The work that Grant is doing, that is going to have to be spatialized. And just one other point that I wanted to just expand another point. Do we, because we are real, do we have audio sound? The Robin tweeting, the grass blowing, and the answer is no, definitely not. Because in real life, someone whispers your name, you might accept that. In VR, someone is going to whisper your name, and you have to make the same audio, and it's improved, it won't happen. Right? So it has to be.
So the other thing, the other thing is that is a very much a stylistic distinction. So for Burned, we wanted to go for more of a verite feel rather than a cinematic feel. What that means is that we had music for the opening and closing credits as a way to initiate the audience, to guide them into the VR experience, and to guide them out again at the end. But there isn't dramatic underscore as we understand it from a cinematic perspective. Rather, we wanted to have some less musical, textural, interstitial cues in between scenes as you as the participant phase in and out of consciousness through this film. So that we mixed in with Grant's audio design. So as you are overtaken by your medication, you hear this weird kind of buzzing sort of noise mixed in with the sound of breathing and the heart monitor. But we wanted to keep it, as I said, more of a verite feel. I've seen VR films that go for more of a cinematic experience with non-diegetic background music throughout, and that's fine, but that's a decision from a design standpoint that needs to be made and part of the conversation that the composer and the sound designer need to have with the director, showrunner, or developer.
And forgive me if you guys all know this, but diegetic versus non-diegetic means music that is within the world of the play versus music that just seemingly comes from somewhere that has got nothing to do with the actual world. I kind of like when Mel Brooks in High Anxiety has got that school bus going by with the orchestra playing.
I had also like to say that stemming from the early days of film, from when we started to conceive of film music soundtracks, their purpose in and the meaning that they make is to remind us that we are engaged in a fantasy. The band is playing, it's all part of the show. That is why, especially in more recent cinema and video games, the selective use of silence, or at least no music, hits a little closer and creates a more relatable experience to our non-musical reality.
I've also seen that in just normal mixing, when I'm dealing with like a drum kit, you know, if you try to use one of these 3D expanders, the stereo expanders, the drum kit can lose all of its power. There's something about the centralization of that sound that wants a narrower stereo field. Once you get too wide, the kick loses focus and the snare might lose focus. And so I just wonder about how that will also, you know, you may not exactly want a score that's spatialized because it loses its focus, its clarity. It becomes too ambient, too sort of diffused in a way.
We also have to remember, we've been conditioned to listen to music, especially out of two speakers. And it's a very, listening to music is very direct, it hits us very much in our face or our chest. And so hearing music in a three-dimensional context is unfamiliar, so it doesn't feel right yet. But same way with, you know, the Beatles mix everything mono, and then the assistant engineer after everyone at the studio did a stereo mix, because no one gave a shit about stereo. And so we're at the point now where 3D seems kind of bizarre for music or for an audio medium, but once we get familiar with sound in three dimensions, especially when it's head tracked, it'll slowly become a little more normal. And maybe you don't need to get a kick drum in your chest. Maybe it's the low end sits around you most of the time, but who knows? Yeah, or anywhere.
The guys at Oculus, and, from Oculus at GDC, also pointed out that you're going to be dealing with a lot of mono objects now. You know, instead of, it's better to get a whole lot of objects in mono, and then you can place them in space, versus getting a bunch of stereo ambient fields that you're going to overlap to try to create an artificial 3D space. Does that make sense?
Right, so, and that's how I would record live music now. Let's keep it simple, a string quartet. So you've got a closed mic mono microphone for each of the four musicians, and then you have a couple of room microphones just to capture the entire field. But all of those are mono that I then place around with panning around the, I guess, the virtual sound stage, add some EQ and reverb, and there you go.
So this is, are we going to be like seeing a lot of less stereo mixing now and more like mixing down to mono objects? Is that something to talk about?
But the final output that you still stereo or 5-1 or whatever the deliverables need to be.
I think in terms of sources, like sound sources, they should be mono, but they should be spatialized mono.
Is there any reason to capture stuff in stereo for spatialized 3D audio?
It doesn't really make sense anymore. I find it's kind of the way to go, especially for those things.
All right. Well, we're officially into our Q&A time. Grant, do you want to add anything else about this, or working on Burn, or to the group about this subject?
No, I think maybe the one thing that occurred to me is slightly different in VR sort of sound design and mixing and so on, is that there's a certain level of intimacy. So if you have the capacity to move your head around the room and go into the corner and, you know, whatever, see the clock, well, then you shouldn't hear the clock. And I think the Oscars the past year, they ran through the list of films that were up for like the sound award, the sound design award, and every one of them was just like a series of explosions, right? So it's gonna be the re-advent of sort of delicateness, like a quietness, like a new, you know, sort of detailed intimate sounds, I think, is what we might sort of see, at least in the short term.
And what's the best explosion goes to?
Okay, so let's do questions. Kyle.
Okay, so I did a little bit of research into Dolby Atmos, and from what I understand about Dolby Atmos is that the way that it works is that you're given a three-dimensional virtual room and place those mono-recorded objects in that room, and then it renders the RT60, the reverb time, and the other factors, the words I don't remember right now, but it renders those things automatically in order to make it sound like those things are coming from that place in the room. Do you have any experience with, or do you know any software that you could use to combine a Dolby Atmos style thing with a spatialization software? So that you can have the head-related transfer function by using that same method of placing objects in the virtual room.
There is a plugin in Pro Tools called Spatial Audio Designer, U Audio Technologies. It kind of has the same idea where you have where you can place things in 3D space just by moving like a little dot. So you're able to like pick different environments, and so they have different reverbs, different reflections, and you're able to just pan things around just moving the dot.
What was the name of that again?
It's the company is called New Audio Technologies, and New Audio Technologies, and the plugin is called Spatial Audio Designer.
Thank you.
Most of these plugs will all work together in harmony in the system. It depends on how you're, what you're mixing down to, whether it's ambisonic or binaural. They'll all work within like a digital audio workstation. So the Dolby Atmos tools will work in conjunction, and you can work with in conjunction with the Facebook plugins and all these other third-party plugins. They all work together. It all depends on what your final output will necessarily be.
And what is it spitting out at the end? Is it spitting out a multi? Is it surround channel mix? What is it?
Well, I think a lot of these things we're just decoding down to binaural, because we're ended up in headphones. So you may have a large bus structure of a lot of channels that will all be funneled down to two.
There's one thing I think is really important with VR is just experimentation, because none of this stuff really is doing what it's supposed to be doing right now. Like, my background's a little bit different from everybody else because I work with music artists. So the funny thing is, when you're talking to a director, and I've talked to directors before, they don't really know audio, right? Like, you can play them a song and they like it, but you can play them another song and they like that song too, like if it's like a jazzy song or something. But artists, they know when a sound is off and they hate it. So it's funny with VR because stereo works sometimes. Like what this guy was saying, sorry, I forget so many names, but in the very far right, what he was saying with the stereo imaging works because you can do spatialized sound design for all the other stuff, it doesn't really matter. So if somebody's walking around like a subway station, have that sound design stuff spatialized, but have something focused on them, whether it's droning or whatever the hell you want it to do. You can push it far, you can do whatever you want, but the biggest thing I've learned with working with artists and then going into video games and sort of doing both is that nothing's right. It's really start with what do you want it to sound like? Don't care about anything else. Don't care about what sounds real. Pay attention to the behavior of things. So if you drop something, sure. Or if you drop a fat baby, you know what I mean? Like there comes points you have to fake and you're creating stuff and it is stylized. So like, I don't think there's ever gonna be a point where the audio's gonna sound like real life. I think that's a silly goal to have. I think the goal really is to have to get inside of the artist's head. So get inside Kubrick's head, whoever the artist is, but you're hearing what they're doing. So my biggest thing I found is do anything. Grab a drum machine, throw a 50, and I'm talking about Oculus, the SDK right now, throw it 50 feet behind your head, add a lot of reverb to it, throw four of those, see if that sounds better than one. Because in music all the time, when we're doing like beats, we have to like layer kicks like four times or once. And so there's all these techniques, and none of the techniques are like scientific, they just sound good and they work. So that's the biggest thing I've learned is like...
Yeah, it's experimenting. Also, dialogue between artists, composers, filmmakers, the more dialogue the better. Like we're in this amazing stage right now with the medium in that, like you said, experimenting and discovering something and then meeting someone and explaining the discovery, because that's what we're all doing, is how did you end up with that sound? It's the same way it works in music. In VR, it's becoming this this amazing place where people are having these dialogues, because every time there's a moment of discovery, they literally feel like they got to tell the world. And that's why those kind of discoveries are happening like daily, but in so many different aspects of it.
And that's another thing that we, I want to just underline, that it's really a beautiful moment that all of these post houses and different companies will do this openly and talk about this and admit that they don't know anything right now.
And well,
once things get gentrified, that can close down and people start getting proprietary and shutting their doors again. So I think the thing, again, that I like about VR the most right now is that all the smarty pantses have come out of their houses and are talking again in like the center square. And that should happen a lot. And don't assume that because somebody's sitting up here that they know more or less than you do, but the dialogue should happen because we can forge it at this point still.
I like to call this the spaghetti throwing stage. We're seeing what sticks right now. We're taking, as I said before, all these elements from the language and grammars that we have accumulated in our cultural consciousness and trying to see what elements work. For 360 Cinema, we are reinventing and reimagining core concepts like cinematography, editing, mise-en-scene, proxemics, the personification of not only the lens, but an entire rig. What does all of this mean now, and how do we make meaning?
Two more questions. What do you
think? So I'm from the experience in my space, so I'm interested in, are there any good examples of using audio to influence behavior? So if I'm going down that speaker and I want to look to the left to see that leaderboard or whatever that is held up, or if I'm traveling in a car and the car door slams and turn the other way, are there any current examples that are doing that really well?
In VR or ever?
No, not well. Not ever. In VR.
I like the. Have you ever played the Gone Home? Gone Home is an experience that's not yet in VR, but you basically go into an abandoned house and you'll never ever see a character or anything. It's just stuff. And everything that you get from the experience, you infer from audio cues. Somehow they get you to go from the front door through the entire house and every floor into the basement, up the secret staircase, and into the loft with just audio cues. Just something down the hall, a you know, crash of lightning that makes you turn and suddenly there's wind. And just all of those different tools are used to move you through this space.
Yeah,
you know,
so I mean, obviously the opportunity is
Yeah, I mean, would you guys use like Doppler effects and stuff in VR? I mean, is it necessary anymore? Because that's a sort of a fake thing, right? Like, using a Doppler insinuates that something's going, but do you need it in VR anymore?
I think there's, speaking of Doppler, I mean, that's the one we recognize, but Doppler effect happens every day in very minute amounts. We just don't recognize that sound. I mean, that's built into a lot of the process that happens for three-dimensional audio. But to your point about good examples of types of things that grab your attention, it's almost guiding your attention, I think.
A variety of all music and music business aspects, including music for film, music for games, and I'm pretty sure in the near future it would behoove them to move into the spatialized and VR audio space. So just exposing yourself to everything and making note of what you find particularly interesting. Think of your favorite film scores, TV scores, game scores, and then apply that thinking to VR experiences. If you go to festivals like 5Rs and other expos, you'll find things that other people are doing in the video space and the audio space that will appeal to you. And you'll also find things that do not. That is also important learning, because we are all at that stage. We're trying to figure out what works and what doesn't. So define your tools, expose yourself to as much diverse body of work as possible, see what you like, see what you don't like, see what works, see what doesn't work. Listen to things and watch things that you don't like and figure out why it might have worked, why it might have been an appropriate choice, what about it you don't like, where and when it might be appropriate. Anne-Marie?
I just want to add one thing. I think one important thing to think about is that collaboration is key because it's such a new tech. I think people are open to working together and to teaching others how to get things done or even, you know, solve workflow issues. So I think it's not something you can teach in like a day. It's something that you need to just sit side by side with somebody and just go through it.
Yeah, when I had to learn about programming, I was banging my head against the wall until it started to get in there. It was not fair either. Programming was hard. Just was years of just until I got it. But you'll get, I agree. Learn from people that are great at it. I spent a lot of time in studios and I had no idea what compression was for 10 years. And then it just kind of osmotically, the light went off. Exposure. Don't assume that you're going to just learn it on your own. You know, go around to respect other people's experience and like borrow from that. In the back?
Yeah, just with respect to mixing 3D audio, I assume that you're constantly thinking about, you could reasonably play a game, you know, 1,000 times and get to, you know, an infinite amount of game states where your audio elements are interacting with each other. You'd never be able to, as a mixer, experience those elements together in one sitting. So I guess my question is, from your experience, is it possible to account for that? So yeah, your dialogue, music, your sound effects, whatever, and all three, four elements are interacting at the same time, but because you're in the game multiple times, you're never going to know how they will play together.
So I guess it's also like in game things are event driven, but here's also space driven in a different way.
Yeah, no, I think you're absolutely right. Like you won't ever be able to recreate the whole thing. And I think the approach that I take is sort of just be a little chicken and be sort of conservative in terms of like when CRTC decided that all television had to be done in 5.1. We know that not everybody has a sub in their house, and we also know that, like a subwoofer, and we also know that some people do, and it's like wired up really weird, and those bass frequencies, they're gonna go crazy in their basement. So we just, just quiet about it, and that's sort of, that stuff all sort of balances itself out. You sort of experiment over time with, turning it up over years, and eventually it's, you just make it as loud as you like now, I guess, because no one's complaining. And I guess it's sort of the same with VR. I guess it's sort of the Wild West, and we'll just have to sort of see what happens. You do whatever experimentation you can, but yeah, you're absolutely right. So I'm repeating myself, but I'm just gonna like play it kind of conservative in terms of like how loud that little crying baby in the corner of the room is gonna sound. Yeah, kind of in the short term.
Alex, do you have a question still?
I was just going to make a suggestion to everybody. Who has seen the Google Spotlight story Pearl, of the 360 video?
Has anybody seen Google's movie Pearl?
So if you want a great example of spatial audio in 360, and it does spatial audio on the cardboard version, so you don't need to use a high-end headset, get a good pair of headphones, watch that experience. It's by an Oscar-winning director. It's one of the best 360 things I've seen, and the audio is fantastic, and it's spatialized, and it's just, if people are interested in this, I would highly recommend you experience that.
I believe it's free on the internet now, right?
Yeah, it's on YouTube. You can actually watch it.
Pearl.
The name of the character.
It's a heartwarming sort of animation about a dad and his daughter going through different phases.
The Google thing, it's not. You don't have to watch it in 360. You can watch it in 2D, but it's obviously the sound. You want to watch it in 360.
So you have to find a player that's actually giving you real spatialized audio.
No, YouTube the spatialized audio.
Cool.
So you don't need a special.
Very last question.
So we've spoken a lot about how audio data design for VR is really designed with headphones and blank. Headphones like the Meetup that are being built specifically for spatial audio, what just having to do a pair of headphones and those can be open.
Did you guys hear the question? The question is, so we're talking about headphones being the thing now, all the way across the immersive spectrum, and then you've got specialized headphones that are for spatialized audio. Is that overkill, or what any old pair do?
Well, the awesome headphones claim to be able to measure your head or measure your ears, and I think that's an important component, because that's going to deliver the best quality sound for you as an individual. They're not on the market yet. I'd love to actually try them and prove that they can make thousands of them and distribute them. But that technology is hopefully the future of quality pair headphones. There's lots of other companies coming up with technologies to make headphones that are supposed to be, blow everything out of the water. Head tracking is obviously important, but I think the future of head tracking doesn't necessarily have to be built into headphones. And this is, it will eventually, you'll sit with the phone in your pocket, connected to your headphones, and the gyroscopes on your phone will handle the movement, so it won't necessarily have to be handled by the headphone. But I think those kind of headphones will make our experience that much better. Once you can actually get a personalized measurement of your own head, it'll sound better.
And the wearables world is going to be so crazy. I mean, all your biometrics are going to be read all day long, and your position in time and space is going to be known. I think that the tech is so much less relevant than how do you creatively approach this stuff. And a lot of that will be opinion-based, but it's just, the reason I put this particular panel together, and it was not meant to be about the gear, is because I think creative people with experience on, you know, all the things that we've seen with surround and Atmos and everything else, just mono mixes and deliverables to every kind of format, are the people that have an idea of what exclusion of certain ideas are from the ones that should be included, and how you deal with the spectrum, how you deal with people with crappy little TVs or smartwatches that play back YouTube videos or huge IMAX cinemas. And yeah, to your thing, it's about paying attention to all that and what worked and when it was effective and when it just didn't make that much of a difference, right? And again, I'll say that all these tools, there's so many that are free. Most of the tools that I put up have got demos at least. If not, they just have like licensing models where if you're not selling what you make with it, you can use a complete version of it. So just download it and fiddle with it. You know, it's common sense. I want to thank everybody on this panel for being here. You guys are brave for coming up at this stage of the game. I want to again mention, what's Burn's website? Do you have one yet? So it's called BVRMED. Fibers is going to go try to make a deal for it, but you guys got to get your stuff done. Thank you all for coming. I very much appreciate having you here. VRTO is inconsistent in its schedule. We do things when we feel there's a need. So I hope you're all now part of the meetup and you'll pay attention when we do another one, because we do it from our hearts. I appreciate all of the volunteers who really are the reason that these things work as smoothly as they do. Joseph Ellsworth in the back is running our Vive demos. Jesse Blaze, Karina Deef, Sarah Bradley, Chrissy Aitchison, Mika Voicemoon, am I forgetting anybody? Jason Spano, who's not left that demo since he got here. All of our sponsors, Metaverse, iLive, FiveRs. Thank you guys, and enjoy the last half hour that we have together.
Yeah, okay.